Hey folks, Sardar here, and in this episode of Dev with Sardar, we're going to look at the basics of the new Pyproject.toml definition file for Python projects. Pyproject.toml is the way to describe a project's metadata and dependencies for modern Python projects. It's what you want to equip a project with if that project is going to someday be installed and used by other people. It's not as vital if you're only creating a project for your own use. But if you have plans to turn your project into something you distribute, Pyproject is the way to go. So let's take a look at a simple project and its corresponding Pyproject file. I have here a program that reads in text in the markdown format and converts it to HTML using the CommonMark library. And that's its only external dependency. You'll notice that the project layout we have for it, the code is in a source directory, and this layout is what's recommended for Pyproject style projects. Now, my project file needs to have, at the very least, information about the project and its dependencies. And since we have dependencies listed here, that means we don't need a requirements.txt file for this project. We use pyproject.toml instead of requirements.txt because it does more. So the toml format looks a little bit like the any file format. There are sections that are named in braces, and then in each section we have key value pairs that are designed to look like Python variable declarations. This makes it easy for a Python developer to look at a toml file and just parse it by eye. And in this particular file, right now we only have one section enabled, the rest is commented out, and that section is called project. And that, as you can guess, holds the metadata about this project. So an absolutely minimal Pyproject file would only need two pieces of data, the project name and its version. But since we have external dependencies, we have to list those as well. And we list them as if they were a Python list, each one separated by commas. And we use the same format for describing dependencies that we also use in requirements.txt. Now, to install the requirements that we have here, we use a slight variation on pip install. Normally, we'd use the R flag to pass the requirements from requirements.txt. But here instead, we use the E flag, E for editable, which I will explain in a moment. And then for what to install, we just pass a dot, which means use the package in this directory. So when you run this, pip will take your Pyproject file, install the base requirements, and also set up your project as a package in this environment. And this last step is done in such a way that instead of copying the files into the venv, it just references them in place. That's what the E for editable means. You can continue editing the source code for your project and running it as is, without having to rerun the setup process every time you make a minor change to the source. Now, the rationale for installing a project into the environment is that it gives you a way to test it in the same way that your users will be installing it and running it. Now, you'll also notice that after the install process finishes up, there are a couple of new directories. For instance, we have the egg-info directory, and you can leave that stuff as is. It doesn't cause any harm. And once the process finishes, we can perform a pip list, and you can see we have our dependencies installed in the environment. And again, we also have the project itself installed as a package as part of the build process. And you'll notice our project has the project directory itself listed as its source. Okay, so much for setting up base dependencies. Now, what if we want to add things like optional dependencies for development work? So to do that, we can add another section to Pyproject. We call it project.optionaldependencies. And there we can give a name we use for a different group of dependencies, in this case dev, and the dependencies to install with it. And this is another way Pyproject is a little more flexible than things like requirements.txt, because everything can be kept in one file and described in a much more flexible way. So if we save this and we run pip install again, we can specify the extra dependency set to install by passing it at the command line, like this. We do pip install -e.dev. And after the setup process finishes, we now have black as our development dependency. So this gives you an idea of how you can use a dependency set with Pyproject. Now, one last neat little trick I'll show, and which gives you an idea of what kinds of other useful things you could do with Pyproject, is to create a command line script version of your app. So for instance, if I wanted to run my program by just typing render HTML at the command line, after installing it in this environment, this is how I could accomplish that. So first we need to add a couple of extra sections in Pyproject. One of them is the build system section. This is basically a piece of boilerplate that we copy as is. It just invokes Python's native setup tools functionality. There are other tool sets that could, in theory, eclipse this functionality, but we want to use the baseline stuff, so we have to specify it. And the other thing is that we add a section that describes the entry points for each of the project scripts that we're going to create. We could create more than one command. So if I want a command line app named render.html, I use this syntax here to define the name and what entry point in my app to invoke when I type that command. So in this case, it's the module render.html.render and the function main in that module. And again, this command name could be anything. It could be just render if I wanted, but I'm using render.html to be explicit. So if I save this and rerun pip install, after that's finished, you'll see that now we have in our venv a render.html.exe, which we can invoke from the command line and run our app with. By the way, one more fun little thing for Microsoft Windows users. If you want your command to run headless with no window and no console, except for one that you create manually, you can use project.gui scripts instead of project.scripts to achieve this. One more thing I should point out about this trick is that it is not a standalone Python app builder. It just creates a shortcut in the form of an exe to the program that's installed in our environment, but that still makes it very handy. So to sum up, Pyproject.toml is what modern Python projects should use for metadata and dependencies, especially if you're creating a project to be reused by others. You don't need much in Pyproject.toml for starters, just enough to describe your project and its base dependencies, if any. But over time, you can add dependency sets for development and testing, and you can add other instructions for the build process, such as how to create a command line script version of your app for deployments. So that's it for now. If you like this video, leave a comment below, and don't forget to follow Dev with Serdar and InfoWorld on Facebook, YouTube, and InfoWorld.com.